Special Sunday broadcast for overseas listeners. Thank you. Hello, I am speaking Dr. Deshbandhu Vajpayee from KANAK Polytherapy Clinic and Research Center, 67/70 Bhusatoli Road, Bartan Bazar, Kanpur. And my mobile number is 860-462-9190. Today, the broadcast is especially for the overseas listeners who are interested in Ayush therapies like Ayurveda, Homoeopathy, Unani, Yoga and Nature Cure and Siddha therapies simultaneously. So this special broadcast is done on Sunday for entire global community who understand English language, and in our daily practice we deliver our transmission in Hindi language. So this is a special broadcast for entire global community. Thank you, listen it. Ayurveda now, for all and every person. In Ayurveda it is told by the olden practitioners that why every person should study Ayurveda for the benefit of his life. So, one feature of the cultivation of Hindu medicine to which attention should be particularly drawn. This is the subject matter. And India is a country of caste and guilds, as you know, that there is very diversity in the castes in India. So that this division is done accordingly in the olden days, and nobody can say how it is started and how it came in existence. So nobody can tell it with a conformity. So, but in Ayurveda, the Charak says that the science of life should be studied by every person. Charak says that the science of life, that means the Ayurveda, should be studied by every person and every caste. There is no any bar which is a and is he learning. He told it to the entire persons that everybody can learn Ayurveda and follow the rules of Ayurveda in his life. So particularly he indicates to study the Ayurveda for Brahmins, Kshatriya and Vaishyas. So Brahmins should learn it for doing good to all creatures. It is said for the Brahmins that Brahmans should learn it for doing good to all creatures. Kshatriyas should learn it for self-preservation. And Vaishyas should learn it for gain for practice as a profession. In general, all may study it for the acquisition of religious merit, wealth and pleasure. So the aim was, Ayurveda was to gain the 100 years life. How to achieve this 100 years, that was a matter. If you take it with the discipline in your life conditions, so that you may able to get the goal of 100 years of your age. So that was the basic concept of Ayurveda, how to achieve 100 years and 120 years, which was the practice of Ayurvedicians at that time. So how to achieve that goal of 100 and 120 years, that was told by the charak, that the science of life should be studied by Brahmans, Kshatriyas and Vaishyas and everyone. And Brahmans should learn it for doing good to all creatures. Kshatriyas should learn it for self-preservation. Vaishyas should learn it for gain for practice as a profession. In general, all may study it for the acquisition of religious merit, wealth and pleasure. So that was the goal. If you want to achieve pleasure, if you want to achieve wealth, if you want to have a religious merit, then you should have to go for the path of Ayurveda to get the all. So that was the main motto of that time. So in Sutra Sthan, it is written by Charak that in course of time, however, the study and practice of medicine, like every other occupation, came to be confined to a particular caste, that is the Vaidyas, an honorific epithet, meaning students of the Veda, which of the Ayurveda. So, in this statement, there is much more controversy. Now, our knowledge has been increased in such a manner that we can analyze very minutely in every sense. So, this is said in the past. So, a special group of practitioners have cropped up to practice the Ayurveda, which was related to study of Ved in olden time. So, it is said also that we have got the specific features in regarding this, that those who are studied the Veda and those who are practicing astrology. In Veda you will find some astrological celestial introduction. Very little bit have been given and their speed. So many things are given there. So it is said, it is believed that at a time the Ayurvedicians, those who are practicing astrology, they are expertise in Veda also. So Veda was the primary one, and those who are studied Veda, they are practicing astrology, and those who are practicing astrology and studying Veda, because in Veda you will find the, if you go through the Veda, you will find that the description of some medicines, some herbs and some herbal which are found in jungles, their qualities and their specific uses in ill conditions. So it is, you will find in Veda, and that came in, it is said that if you use it as these herbs in any disease condition, so they have grouped it all the herbs and make a sense of that they are using in life conditions. So they picked up and categorized it in a segregated manner and named it Ayurveda. So Ayurveda came in existence with the practitioners, those who were practicing astrology and studied the Veda and teaching Veda to next generations and up to generations to generations. So that came in practice after that. So it was the tradition at that time to give or to shift knowledge to one generation to other generation by memorizing method and transfer it to next generations by the similar way up to the existence when scripts came in existence. As I have told you earlier that the knowledge was transferred to elder to coming ones and from generation to generation. So it is said about this Ayurveda also that abundant evidences occur of the Vaidyas having been always a literate caste. Those are the Vaidyas at practicing at that time. They were understood to be a very intelligent person and a very literary one. So their caste have been segregated at that time because they were literate much more and they think over it. So science has also recognized the principle of heredity as one of the most powerful factors in the communication of both intelligence and skill in every craft. Now it is well known fact that science has recognized the principle of heredity, that in heredity if everybody is getting something then it goes to next generation and up to the next generation. So the principle of heredity is applicable here. So science has recognized the principle of heredity as one of the most powerful factors in the communication of both intelligence and skill in every craft. So now this fact is still correct today. So the facilities again of instructions where the teacher is a father, an uncle or an elder brother, and the pupil a son, a nephew, and younger brother, or any other loved relative, are simply abundant. So, the factor is that communicating this knowledge to next generation, the instructions is given to the any person who want to gain the knowledge in their own way. So, the instructions is given to the by the teacher to any person, anyone who are interested in learning, and if he desire to learn a specific studies, so he can go to a learned person and he oblige it with giving the knowledge which he have. So that kind the person can be a anyone can be. So now it is said that the teacher is a father or uncle or an elder brother, and the pupils are to which knowledge is transferred to next generation. It could be a son, it could be a nephew, it could be a younger brother or any relative or any person. So the pupil resides with the instructor. So this was the tradition at that time that pupil resides with the instructor, whoever it may be. He receives a training that is both theoretical and practical. So at that time the instructor transfers his knowledge to his pupil in two ways. He is giving the theoretical and practical knowledge both. At that time, the absence of hospitals and infirmaries is, as already said, no bar to clinical study for the student accompanies the teacher to the bedside of the latter's patient. So there is no bar. Students can take advantage of his studies, whatever, how much he can study everything. So there was no bar limit. Hindu pharmacopoeia depends very largely on herbs and plants. So now it is said that the pharmacopoeia of Hindu medicine depends very largely on herbs and plants. In the absence of a knowledge of scientific botany, the identification of these is always attended with difficulty. Now at that time the jungles were in very prominent condition, and everyone sees the herbs and trees, so they recognize it very well and find it very easily. They know that in which season the botanical parts are should be taken, in which season and should be collected for the treatment purpose or for the medicinal preparation purpose. So this was the tradition at that time. So everybody was understanding it, that how much time it takes to ripe the herb and how to collect it in at which condition and at which time. So in the case of pupils belonging to the family of the teacher and residing with him in the same premises, the facilities are very ample of acquiring a thorough practical knowledge of herbs and plants. So it was a very easy one, that I have already told you that the transfer of the knowledge is depending upon the teacher, and in between teacher and the pupil. So the teacher transferred the knowledge to pupil, and he was generally pupils were residing with the family of teachers at that time, at the olden time, and whatever their activities are taken, they are taken simultaneously and with the families of the teachers. So there is a facility for very ample of acquiring a thorough practical knowledge of herbs and plants. So it is true. So now it is true that students unconnected in blood with the preceptor also take up their residence with him and are for all purposes regarded as members of his family. So now this is a fact that students which are not connected with the blood relation of teacher or any learned person, so they are taken just like their family members and residing with them. They are regarded as a family member, and they get a facility, every facility given by the teachers to their pupils, and there is no any bar in between or any you can say that any changes in between, any partition or any changes in between the selection of teachers and pupils. So in the eye of teacher, the every student is equal. Even then, if he is included his son and is related to other unconnected in blood persons, so the teacher understand is a family member and nothing else. So he give all the teachings which he have. Yet the preceptor, whatever the measure of his impartiality, naturally feels a greater affection for the children of his own family than for students that are strangers to him in blood. So teacher does not segregate everyone, that he is not my relative. You don't understand himself or not make a partiality in between the teachers and the students which are not their relative, not particular relative or belonging to other caste. That does not matter with them. So it was a tradition at that time. So what happened, the teacher give them the practical training and theoretical training equivalent to everyone, and he does not hide even the least to his pupils. He give whatever he has in his own mind or what he has in his own brain and in own knowledge. So just I have told you that the teacher does not segregate or make a partiality in between the students or hide anything to students. He gave whatever he have in his own mind or in his own practice or in his own hand, and don't hide anything to any student. He give it to all. He understand that all students are equivalent to like his son, and whatever he have knowledge, he give it to every student and to make him perfect in the practice. This is the teacher who done it. He done for the perfection of the student, that he should not fail in his aim at any cost. So that was the aim at that time for the teacher. And the natural desire again of preserving the superiority of his own family would often induce even an honest preceptor to take greater care of pupils connected with him by birth and blood than of those that are not so connected. Speaking of a specific part of India, it is this circumstance that accounts for the existence in some, for a few medical family of great reputation. So these families have for generations practiced the healing art with success. The compiler of Hindu medicine has the honor to belong to some of the families, and many of them were highest titles of honor known to the profession. So that the honor is given by the king. At that time the kingship was very in existence, and those teachers and preceptors transfer the knowledge of Ayurveda to other caste and to other persons. They are honored by the king, and the king supports them. So this was the tradition at that time, to honor the teachers, to honor the specific Ayurvedicians who are practicing at that time by the kingpins. Now, in this section, I would like to tell you about the fundamentals of Ayurveda, which should be understood by everyone, and should experience with the Ayurveda principles and Ayurveda teachings. It is said the theory of health and disease as expounded in Hindu medical treatises, it is very easy to understand. It's not very difficult to understand the principles of Ayurveda, the basic fundamental principles of Ayurveda. They are related with the natural resources which are found in earth. So a living creature is composed of soul, mind and body. Everybody knows it, that a person is having the soul, mind and body. And the Ayurvedic practitioner Punarvasu says that this trinity rested on union like three sticks standing with one another support. It is just like a table, a three-leg table which supports the table base, the soul, mind and body. So this is just like a stool, three-leg stool you can say. So these are the basic principles in which the soul, mind and body is existed. in everyone. This trinity rests on union like three sticks standing with one another support. The compound is called Purush or Being. All three, when make it, so they are called Purush or Being. It is this compound of soul, mind and body that is the subject matter of the science of life. The science of life is depend on the three subject matter, that is soul, mind and body. So three, the composition of these three things make a man, make a human being. So the soul is regarded as immutable and it is incapable of being affected by anything. So in the Hindu philosophy, it is recognized that the soul is regarded as immutable. The soul cannot be mutated. So it is incapable of being affected by anything. It is eternal and it is regarded as the witness, for it views all things without being itself affected by anything. So this is the philosophical task of Hindu philosophies. The seven Hindu philosophies are based on the soul, body and mind. So basically these three are very important when we think over it, that about the human being. So the body, like all other material objects, has for its constituent elements the five primordial essences: earth, water, fire, air and ether. So that is the concept of Ayurveda, that body is consist of the everything which is found in this earth and its atmosphere and in space also. So the body, like other all other material objects, has for its constituent elements the five primordial essences: which earth, water, fire, air and ether. These exist in the shape of juices, blood, flesh, bones, adipose, marrow, semen and ojas. So all the three things which I have told you earlier, that earth, water, fire, air and ether, they exist in the shape of juices, blood, flesh, bones, adipose, bone marrow, semen and ojas. So united with the senses are the instruments by which the mind acts. The compound is called animate, and without them it is inanimate. So it is said that body is composed of the five elements. These five elements are earth, water, fire, air and ether. So these are the properties of earth which we found it, and we get it, and we assume that human body is consist of these all five matters. So which is existed in this earth, and the earth is composed of these all things. So everything, every property is get it in the body of every human being, and especially the chemical which are found in this earth, they are get it, and they are inside to every person. And every person is composed of these chemical substances which found in this earth. And this is the basic concept of Ayurveda. So that body is built of these all things. So the concept goes to basically on these five things: the water, the earth, the fire, or you can say sun, the space and the air. So so these all five things have made the is found in every person of this earth. So basically we can say that a human being or everything is made of these five things, the chemicals which are found in our and the properties which are found in this earth. Every person and every vegetable and everything, every creature, every person, even then the bacteria are consist of these chemicals, and everything is found in their bodies which are found in this earth. This is the basic concept of Ayurveda. Now in other transmission we will tell you the further talk and we'll talk you further. Thank you. We have some videos for your listening and browsing purposes from our archive, and we have taken some important collection for you to give you a glimpse of these archives videos which are loaded in previously. Now this is for you all, and I think that you have enjoyed it very well. Now we are ending our program, and in next week we will see you.